Gildan Media, a division of Recorded Books, presents Stiff Them, your guide to paying $0 to the IRS, student loans, credit cards, medical bills, and more. By Dr. Gary S. Goodman. Narrated by Dr. Gary S. Goodman.
Introduction and Preview. Sure, in a perfect world, you want to do the right thing and meet every single obligation. Don't we all? But when it comes to paying back exorbitant amounts of debt, being virtuous in this way, it's too expensive, and most of us simply can't afford it. There's a reason you and tens of millions of others are buried in debt. Today's world is set up so most of us will fail financially. We're enticed to purchase what we don't need, to accept and use credit cards we can't pay, and to rack up student loans that lead to knowledge not in demand and jobs that don't exist. 44% of Americans are underemployed, which means you are overqualified by virtue of experience or education, and you're underpaid. Where are you going to find the money to get the necessities of life, let alone to retire IRS debts, student loans, usurious credit cards, subprime car loans, and other obligations? Your health care plan probably isn't a genuine health plan, but an illusion, a trap with a huge deductible, big premiums. From personal experience, I can tell you, one trip to the emergency room without an overnight stay or even an ocean view can run a tab of $18,000 for a kidney stone that passes from your body without surgery or any medicinal intervention. Should you stay awake at night sweating over not paying a bill like that? And if you choose to suffer with guilt or remorse, what good does it do? You don't get extra points for berating yourself or being distracted from other significant aspects of your life. What options do you have? Gladly, there is a remedy expressed in this two-word marching order: stiff them. Pay less or pay nothing, but know this, you don't have to pay as agreed. The outfits that are badgering folks like you for payment are in business to withstand losses. They've already priced into the cost of their money, their goods and services, what you owe and more, in the expectation that they will not get paid by a significant number of people. Take the IRS, the most aggressive collection agency in the world. Will the IRS shut its doors if you don't pay in full the demand they sent you? If the government runs short of funds, it will print more money, one way or another. Plus, there are billionaires that don't pay a penny in tax. But as you can imagine, there's an art and a science to untangling the debts and other financial tentacles that are squeezing the joy in life from you. I'm going to teach you two things. First, how to repay these entities super cheaply if you feel you must. So, you'll be significantly or at least partly stiffing them and not totally and utterly stiffing them. This is the pay pennies on the dollar approach to debt settlement. Second, I'll show you how to escape repayment completely if your circumstances require it, your hardships are so great, or if you simply are ornery or a complete flake and you don't want to pay a penny. I've been in the business of tax resolution, credit card and medical debt resolution, student loan consolidations and collections, and I have consulted to major financial companies such as Discover Card. I know how the IRS works and the many ways you can pay less in taxes or pay nothing at all. Completely legal ways, mind you. I've helped hundreds of people to pay back zero or tiny amounts to resolve millions of dollars of debt. I've helped graduates and dropouts to escape from student loan hell to pay, in many cases, $0 per month with total debt forgiveness after a stated term of years. I teach best practices in negotiation at the two highest-rated universities in the United States, and I'm a licensed attorney. I know the ins and outs of bankruptcy. Now, I'm not providing legal advice, but we'll dedicate an entire section to probing things like the tyranny of the FICO score, how to beat the credit bureaus. I had a brilliant professor in college who issued this advice to those of us that were studying economics. Borrow heavily when you are young, because you will be paying back in cheaper dollars. He was right. Inflation made the student loans I took out far cheaper by the time I had to repay them. But I have that teacher beaten when it comes to advice. I say borrow heavily at any age because you can very possibly pay back in $0. Why am I sharing these insider tips with you? Certainly, I like writing, and I want to sell a few books, but I'm really a David versus Goliath kind of guy. As my dad put it in our family, we always root for the underdog. That's my thing. The IRS, the big banks, the medical industrial complex, and others, they have plenty of clout and money, and they're used to getting their way. If I can put a pebble or two into your slingshot to lower their odds of beating you into submission, then it's my pleasure to do so. In the material that follows, you'll notice many counterintuitive insights that change the playing field to your advantage. Chapter by chapter preview. Lots of books tout the virtues of becoming debt-free. To me, that's a little too simple-minded. There are two kinds of debt, as you'll soon see, good and bad. You'll learn about them in Chapter 1. Obviously, you should consider each one in a different light. Bad debt is probably what you're saddled with today, so we'll invest a lot of time talking about minimizing it and zeroing it out. But good debt is an entirely different breed. What are the vital differences? We'll find out in Chapter 1. They say you don't get what you deserve in life, you get what you're able to negotiate, especially in credit card debt resolution. In Chapter 2, we're going to explore the essentials of exploiting your bargaining power. And when it comes to debt elimination, you have plenty of it. You may not feel that way at this very moment, but at the end of this chapter, you'll probably have a change of heart. Everything is negotiable. Chapter 3 sings the praises of bankruptcy as a means of zeroing out your debts and getting a fresh start. As a rule, bankruptcy gets a bad rap, especially from creditors. There's a good reason they recoil like Dracula seeing the dawn, streaking through the window. Their right to collect from you will turn to ashes when you file for Chapter 7. You'll learn how this is different than Chapter 13, and you'll develop insights into bankruptcy as a possible remedy for your debt troubles and as a platform for quickly rebuilding your creditworthiness. We all know there are two immutable forces in life, death and taxes. I'll show you that this notion is only half true. In Chapter 4, you'll learn how to stiff the IRS. Legally, of course, there's a vital difference between tax avoidance, which legendary Judge Learned Hand said is every American's right, and tax evasion, which is what they nailed gangster Al Capone for, providing him with a glorious opportunity to die in prison. This program isn't about seizing every available deduction, and there are notably fewer since the recent changes made in the tax code by the U.S. Congress. It's about reducing or eliminating the tax debt that remains after you have incurred it and have been billed for it by the IRS. In Chapter 5, we'll turn our attention to student loan forgiveness, how to pay fewer or even $0 on your educational debts. You'll learn how student loan debt exceeds credit card debt, and it's a burden being borne by more than 40 million people. Chances are very good that you've graduated and are underemployed. This means you're laboring in a job beneath your training and experience. And if this is the case, you're being paid far less than you imagined receiving when you took out your student loans. We'll talk about qualifying for deferred and reduced monthly outlays that may amount to $0 per month, depending on your income. Managing your debts and pursuing any of the remedies provided in this program is not a simple matter of do this and do that. Of course, there are some procedures that need to be followed, as I've indicated, but addressing your debts and resolving to resolve them takes a decision on your part. Equally important, in Chapter 6, we explore a crucial question. Why try to pay off your bills? Debtors can waste time and resources throwing good money after bad. They make minimum payments for years and years without denting the overall size of their credit card debts. This makes banks happy because they maximize their interest earnings, but it robs debtors of the ability to invest their modest resources elsewhere. You'll see how if you're exerting superhuman effort in most endeavors, including debt resolution, you're probably doing something terribly wrong. If you ask most people what they regret about making crucial decisions regarding their finances, especially filing bankruptcy, they won't say they should not have done it. They ask, why didn't I do it sooner? Chapter 7 will help you to restore your financial self-confidence. Once you've decided to take action, you'll need to recover your monetary self-esteem and mojo. You've taken a hit and cut your losses, and now you need to climb back in the saddle. Part of this will be accomplished by making better financial choices. You'll see that going through hardships and suffering losses is part of the trajectory of the rich and famous. You'll understand that your excesses weren't caused merely from wrongful spending. They were the result of wrongful lending as well. Punctuating your financial experiences properly, putting them into the most sympathetic perspective, will enable you to focus on getting good credit instead of bad and accumulating wealth instead of useless debts. You're going to like what's ahead. These insights and immediately practical tips will help you to take back the power that we needlessly yield to these petty tyrants, creditors, and place that power squarely in your hands, where it belongs. Chapter 1, Good Debt versus Bad Debt. Most of us think we know what debt is all about. All we have to do is check out the bills we receive and our credit card balances. We borrow and we owe more than we borrowed because of interest charges, so we have to pay it back. What else is there to know? A lot, as it turns out. When I was in college, I bought a book with an odd, counterintuitive title, How to Borrow Your Way to a Great Fortune. The author, Tyler Hicks, sang the praises of OPM, which stands for Other People's Money. His thesis is, if you can put other people's money to better use than they can, then borrow it. Pay them interest, of course, which they'll be happy to view as the highest and best use of their funds. But you'll know better because you're bringing in a much better return on their money than they're receiving. This may seem abstract, but it isn't. It's the age-old capitalistic concept of buying low and selling high. In this case, you're buying or renting, if you like, money. And then you're reselling the same money you've been loaned, but at a higher rate. Technically, and quite practically, you're going into debt for the purpose of turning a profit, or in some cases with the idea of building long-term wealth. Seen this way, incurring debt is not only okay and not to be avoided, it is something to purposely acquire because the way you treat it, debt becomes an asset. Just as you need steel, plastic, and increasingly today, aluminum to build cars, you need debt, and the more the merrier, to create wealth. That's what author Hicks is saying. This is good debt. Debt that puts you in a better position tomorrow than you're in today is actually positive. If there's good debt, there must be the other kind, right? Yes, it's bad debt, and we'll get into that in a minute. But let's start with an example. If you buy a house, as a general rule, you're taking on good debt. Why is this? As you know, homes usually appreciate in value. They'll sell for more in the future than they do today. And despite tax reform, which has limited the amount you can write off on your property taxes, there are still advantages to home ownership. For one thing, as long as you pay your mortgage, taxes, and insurance, and the state doesn't forcibly buy your home to blow it down for a new highway, you can live there uninterrupted for the remainder of your days. That confers serenity, and that is an antidote to the other stresses of modern life. This peace of mind and ability to plan long term, where you'll be, delivers psychic income. You can't cash it in at the bank, but it is meaningful. If you contrast it with the insecurity renters can feel being subject to big price increases and the whims of owners who can sell it out from under you, there is much to be said for home ownership, if only based on the feeling of control it confers. Of course, one of the downsides of stiffing them, walking away from your bills, is that it can make qualifying for a home loan later on more difficult. However, there are various workarounds. You can get owner financing if the people that are selling have the deed to the place and are willing to carry back all or part of the mortgage amount. This is a smart strategy even if you have sterling credit, because you can avoid paying high loan fees to conventional mortgage lenders. Of course, even with bad credit, if your down payment is sufficient, you can find lenders that are willing to take the risk. They know, in case they have to foreclose, they will receive their entire investment back. I'm getting a field here. Suffice it to say, home ownership is mostly a good idea, and the debt it requires you to take on is good debt. It positions you well for the future because it is an appreciating asset. In How to Borrow Your Way to a Great Fortune, Tyler Hicks recommends buying a lot of houses for the purpose of renting them out. If your rents cover your expenses, you're in good shape. And he is very high on the idea of getting owner financing. The key to real estate investing is leverage. This means a few things, but basically, the less you need to put down in cash to buy a property, the better your gains will be. Let's say you purchase a home for $400,000, and it appreciates in value by 3% per year on average. After owning it a year, it is now valued at $412,000. On paper, you've made a gain of $12,000. If you made an initial down payment of $80,000, your return on that investment is not $80,000 times 3%. That would be $2,400. A decent stock could pay you that amount in dividends. Your return is actually 3% times $400,000, or as I said before, $12,000. You've made a nifty 15% return on your $80,000 down payment money in a single year. Let's say instead of $80,000, which is 20% of the purchase price, you could buy for only 10% down, or by investing only $40,000. Then that $12,000 gain would represent an astonishing return of 30% to you. That's just year one. Through what is often called the miracle of compounding, your home, now valued at $412,000, will appreciate by 3% in year number two. That means it will increase by $12,360 and will be worth $424,360. If you put down $40,000, you will have already realized a payback of 60.9% of it after 24 months. After year three, the home will be valued at $437,090. By that time, your payback on the down payment will almost be complete. You will be looking at a return of 92.7% of what you put in originally. The miracle, the magic, is that your 90% of debt on the property is earning you money at compounding rates of return, while you are repaying your mortgage at simple interest, while you are mowing the lawn, eating breakfast, and sleeping soundly at night. This isn't just good debt, it's great debt. I should point out that if you sold your home after year one using a realtor, your gain would probably be eaten up by his or her fees, which typically run 5%, but you're not going to cash out that soon. Plus, you can always take a short course, get your own real estate license, a sales license, and this could be used to negotiate a split of commissions with the listing realtor. I've done this, and I currently have a California broker's license, entitling me to a bigger slice of the pie. Once more, good debt positions you for a better future. Bad debt does the opposite. It mires you in the past, paying for trifles that depreciate in value or have been completely consumed. Buying clothing on a department store's credit card is an example of bad debt. Typically, the clothes are fashion items designed to become obsolete after a season or two. They're poorly made, they wear out easily, and they cost too much. Now, on top of these faults, you're borrowing to finance these flimsies. That's just all kinds of stupid. Over time, my philosophy has become better to wear it out than throw it out. Playing tennis the other day, my wife noticed my shirt was becoming more holes than shirts, so we tossed that one away at the park. I've extended the life of so many things that when I do buy a half dozen socks, which I did yesterday, it's time to break out the champagne. I would also classify some student loan debts as good ones. You might expect a guy with 5 earned degrees to say as much, but I mean it. As Plato reportedly said, education is the one good thing we can't get too much of, and I agree with him. But there are smart ways to take on student loan debt. For example, as a general rule, federally insured student loans are not dischargeable in bankruptcy, with a few exceptions that I cover in another section. But as I write this, I can tell you that many private student loans can be wiped out in a Chapter 7 liquidation case. That is something to remember if you believe there are 3 immutable forces: death, taxes, and student loan repayments. I have to say, you need to attend an accredited institution of higher learning or a trade school that has a solid track record of placing its graduates in paying jobs. Don't kid yourself that a buy-your-degree mill that is in the printing business and not the education field will do you any good except to take your dough and put you into debt. I appeared on the same dais as a prominent speaker and up-and-coming author. He called himself Dr. So-and-so, and he referred to himself that way throughout his talk. We got to know each other, and I had a client who was seeking another speaker for an annual sales meeting. I thought this fellow would be perfect, but that doctor title didn't quite seem right. Dynamic as he was in speaking to audiences, he didn't strike me as the type that would really develop new knowledge, as legitimate PhDs like me are trained to do. So before putting his name into play for the occasion, I looked up his school that granted the doctorate. Actually, I asked the research librarian at the University of Southern California, where I graduated, to do it for me. He reported that it was a diploma mill. If you paid enough money, you could use your life experiences as substitutes for attending classes, and you could tender a simple research paper and call it your doctoral dissertation. Long story short, my new pal was a phony. Well, at least his degree and claim to being an intellectual was fraudulent. I called him and urged him to drop the doctor title. "You don't need it," I said. He did exactly that. He was a smash hit at my client's event. And the same fellow went on to become a co-editor of one of the best-selling self-help books of all time. His phony degree was a time bomb. Sooner or later, he would have been unmasked as an imposter. Don't go into debt to get that kind of pretend education. That said, there are some other things to avoid. Paying out-of-state tuition, which is about the same as private university prices, is dumb. If you're going to attend a state school, go to your own. Also, community colleges can be tremendous bargains for the first 2 years, even at today's prices. When I went, I paid the grand sum of $750 to take up to 18 semester units. That's not a misprint or a misstatement. $7.50 is all I paid for that virtually limitless buffet of classes, all of which counted toward my degree, which I completed at State University. Then I went on to get my master's at State and my PhD on a partial scholarship for a year one, and then a fully paid assistantship for years 2 and 3. My MBA and JD were earned at expensive private schools, and by the time I attended, I made enough income to pay for these out of pocket as I went. To pay my living expenses for my bachelor's degree, I took out federally insured student loans, which I paid back with ease after they became due. But they were deferred for years while I earned the MA and PhD. And this is worth a comment. Remember my economics professor at community college that looked us straight in the eye and made this suggestion, borrow heavily when you're young because you'll be paying back in cheaper dollars? What did he mean? For one thing, we can almost always count on a certain amount of inflation to make our currency worth less and less. When I did repay my loans, I was paying 7% interest on top of the principal I borrowed. But the cumulative amount of inflation between the years I borrowed and repaid vastly exceeded 7%. I paid back ultimately in 25% cheaper dollars. Plus, my degrees became worth more and more as time passed because there was inflation in wages during that time as well. People are saying the nation's deficit is going to increase by trillions of dollars. This means inflation is around the corner, and the amount of it could be huge. Instead of seeing a fairly normal 1% to 3% rise in annual prices, we could be looking at 10, 15, or even 20% price hikes. If you're borrowing at fixed rates and paying simple interest, as you would do with some student loans, then it could make sense to take my professor's advice, even if you don't consider yourself to be young anymore. Borrowing heavily in the next few years could make perfect sense.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.